Dinner Conversations is brought to you by Food for the Hungry, an incredible relief and community development organization serving those with physical and spiritual needs around the world for 50 years this year.
Help us as we help our friends at Food for the Hungry save thousands of lives in Ethiopia today by considering a generous gift.
A gift that will be matched 22 times.
Your one-time gift will make an eternal difference. So visit fh.org/dinner to give now.
Well, here's another one that I'd heard the name. Mm-hmm. But because I'm not a music aficionado, is that a word?
Yeah, aficionado.
But Bryan White, and I put him on the Facebook today, and man, people are, Bryan White, how do you know Bryan White? And I, well, he knows me too. No, it's an amazing episode. I've enjoyed this one.
Yeah, he is just a really classic country artist from the, yeah. I grew up listening to him. On the country radio, songs like Rebecca Lynn and From This Moment On with Shania Twain. He was defining a younger generation of country music. So I was kind of fanboying. But I know his brother, Daniel White, here in Nashville. So he introduced us and we just let him tell his story about identity. It's more than if you're a celebrity or not. We all put so much stock into what we do or how we present ourselves. And this is getting us back to the basics of who we are, and that's not always what we do.
So if your identity is wrapped up in what you do, we have one seat left at the table, and it's yours. Let's join the conversation. Beloved, you are an amazingly talented writer, singer, and how did you... What happened? Take me back to the beginning. How did people first hear of Bryan White?
Well, I grew up in Oklahoma and come from a long line of farmers, auctioneers, and my dad was the one guy that was the black sheep of the family. He started playing drums when he was a kid and got bit by the music bug and met my mom in high school. And my mom just happened to be a naturally talented singer. And they... eventually started some bands and started playing, the devil's music and then eventually moved to Oklahoma City from their really small rural southwestern Oklahoma towns that they were from. And they jumped in feet first and started, trying to break into the scene in Oklahoma City and did really well for many, many years, essentially put my brother and I through school, playing music.
Really?
So I kind of got the bug. I got it honest from them. And somewhere along the lines of 16 or 17 years old, I can't even remember what the question was you asked me.
Back to the beginning. You're right. You're right on target. 16. How people first heard of you.
Yeah. Okay. So I was fortunate enough through a couple of friends in Oklahoma City to get connected with a guy in Nashville named Billy Joe Walker Jr. And Billy took to my voice and before I had even graduated from high school and said, I'd love to meet with you. Long story short, I made a trip to Nashville, met with him, sang a couple demos for him. And he and his wife took me under their wing and I stayed with them and came up here and eventually moved after I graduated from high school. And I did graduate. and then from then on, I one thing happened after the next. I got a publishing deal. Glenn Campbell signed me to his publishing company.
How cool is that? Just is it, 18-year-old kid or something?
Yeah, 19.
Yeah.
And I really didn't know.
You'd been writing how long before that?
Not long.
Really?
I wouldn't even call myself a songwriter at that point. I wanted to write so bad. And that was the one little catalyst that helped me to really start learning how to write songs, the craft of writing songs. And so through that publishing deal, I got to meet so many people and write with them and co-create with them. And then I eventually got a record deal after that and started, my first record came out in 94.
And so, you were how old at that time?
19, 20, something like that. Yeah.
I think when your first record came out, there are a lot of people who put a lot of years into a lot of records, before something really hits. And I know you had a few singles that, did okay before you had your number ones, but still you had a debut record that comes out as platinum. And I was reading this article that said, really, your music, and I think about
I was growing up as a kid in Texas at that time, hearing Bryan White all the time on the radio. But they said
what
that
part of Texas?
West of Fort Worth, going towards Abilene, yeah, like Weatherford
yeah.
area.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, Azle.
You've been all over Texas.
I'll be in Fort Worth in November, actually.
Oh, really? Okay, yeah, cool. So yeah. Oklahoma.
So we're you were saying.
Yeah,
so
we can get along.
This, yeah, yeah, that's okay. Right.
This is true.
I know, there's no line, but there is. you know, I was just thinking, like, so much success so soon. And oh, and this article was saying that you literally helped define a new younger generation of country music. Of course, this was as pop country was still kind of making its way. We're still coming out of country being fairly traditional, Emmylou Harris, that kind of thing. And they said that you helped redefine a generation of country music because of your youth and because of the sound. And I think the sales and all that followed to affirm that. Do you remember having impressions as a 19, 20-year-old going, okay, this is huge. What do I do with this?
Did you get cocky?
Oh, gosh, for sure. Yeah, everybody. There's no...
How could you not?
There's no human being on earth that can handle that kind of stuff and not, you know...
And 19, 20, especially.
What would you tell that 20-year-old if you could sit down with him and say, okay, listen, not specific things, but like, what would you say to him to help him not do?
First thing I'd say was, I'd look him straight in the eye and I'd say, listen, you're not that big of a deal. And secondly, you aren't your voice. You aren't your career. You're creative for much more than that. And I'd say, don't forget to have fun. I forgot to have fun along the way. It became...
A taskmaster?
Yeah. Yeah, so, but to answer your question, there were definitely moments where I knew something big was really happening, and I can't take credit for like you were saying, we were part of a movement or something. Well, I mean, maybe, but I wasn't the sole decider in a lot of that stuff. You know, I was so young and so green. I just knew. I don't know if I really knew what a hit song was as much as I knew what a great song was. And
what moved you?
People like Kyle Lenning and Billy Joe Walker Jr. and my label, it was kind of a concerted effort on the songs and the material. And so I think it was really a team effort. But I mean, maybe to some degree, my vocal style being a little different and not what was happening at the time, maybe contributed to that. But it was really a team effort for sure, you know.
But do you remember thinking in that time, was it like Mark said, it becoming a taskmaster and probably almost becoming this kind of mini god? It's what careers, I think, have an easy way to do, especially when they elevate that quickly. Did you even think, hey, I'm going down a path that can't sustain itself? Or, were you thinking of sustaining at all? Like, if I want to do this in 30 years?
No, I never thought about that. I didn't have a very linear, I wasn't very linear minded because it happened so young. I thought, well, what are we doing today? It was a day-to-day type of mentality. I didn't have a lot of intuitiveness it's the same thing. I wish I knew then what I know now.
Did you have good people around you?
I think so, without a doubt.
Yeah. Made all the difference, didn't it?
I mean, we all had our differences, and there were, you have arguments with people that you love
but
and you trust.
But they didn't rip you off?
I can't say anywhere along the way that anybody took advantage of me that I was aware of, you know. So I consider that definitely God's providence and covering there.
For sure.
When did it begin to, you had a really long run on that first kind of part of your career journey. Do you remember moments where you're like, okay, this is kind of cracking in your psyche, just in your physical ability to keep up or in expectations of yourself where you're like, this isn't going to fly forever?
I remember always feeling a certain amount of pressure with every little thing that I had to do. I remember being fatigued and tired all the time, and I took that out on everybody around me because I didn't feel like people took the time to think about my well-being as much. You know, I mean, we were all working hard, but there were times where, just 2 years prior, I was, sleeping on a desk in high school, So, so I, to be going at that pace it wasn't anybody's fault because,
you signed up.
Because this is what I signed up for. But there were just times where I didn't want to go do something.
What were your parents thinking? What were they? I mean, were they? Did they know how fatigued you were, or were they thrilled with your success? I'm sure they supported you.
They were musicians.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. I think I always had love and support from grandparents and my parents. And as far as what they thought, I know what my mom thought. I didn't have the tightest relationship with my dad. So, but I do know now, because my mom tells me very openly what she thought a long time ago. I think she felt like I was sort of stolen from her for many years, because, and a couple of little, there were always a couple of little remarks that still stick with me to this day that I don't remember who said them, but there was always, I remember back then somebody said, well, say goodbye to your family and everything that you love for the next few years. And it kind of hit me, you know, kind of aggravated me a little bit, because I was like, what are you talking about?
Yeah,
you know?
I'll see my family.
Well, and it really was that. I mean, I now I realize why my mom felt like that. She just couldn't. Her son was gone, and I don't even think I was exactly the same when I was around her a lot, because I was just so sort of almost indoctrinated by, you know, just your poise and what's going on, and you're playing the radio game, and you've become this box of cookies that's being marketed everywhere. Yeah. So you have a totally different mindset, and it's hard to be normal.
And it goes from that to a cog in the wheel.
Yeah.
You know, where you're just working and exhausted.
For sure.
And so what happened? I mean, I've always said you can either land the plane or crash it, but when it's out of gas, it's coming down. So did you land it, or what happened?
I don't know if I landed it or if it crashed. The jury's still out on that. Yeah. I mean, I knew I was a good singer. I knew I was an exceptional singer, and I had something different. And, you know, obviously that begins to, you start drinking your own Kool-Aid. And, you know, God was not at the center of my life at that time. You know, I had a form of godliness, as they say, but you know, he wasn't the center of my focus. I was the center of my focus. My voice, my career, all that. It was the game of, well, how do we, you know, we're doing a show with this person over here. How do we kick, you know, we got to kick their butt. You know, we got to, you know, show them what we got, you know. And it was always that competitive nature and trying to outdo the last thing that we did. And all the while, you've got a label and management constantly on you about something. You know, why'd you cut your hair, or, you know, you're singing this song too high, can you lower the key? Stop singing all those licks in the solo section. You know, don't close your eyes when you're singing.
No.
And, by the way, we need another Rebecca Lynn. Okay. Just there's this kind of a pressure cooker kind of a thing. So I knew at that point, you know, we were on top of the world and poised to, I don't know, maybe become an arena act or mm-hmm. moving toward that. We needed great songs. And I felt like we had some great songs on this record. And I did sing them too high. I was starting to really push my own envelope to see what I was capable of. And nobody told me, there was one person that did say to me, you know, just because you can sing that high doesn't mean you should. And it was Steve Warner said that to me. He goes, just because you can sing that high doesn't mean you have to, you know. And I had just started to, I was stressed out, not sleeping well. Radio is starting to not play the last couple singles that have come down the pike, and they're critiquing them. And I started to read articles about my voice. And certain people in my camp would say things about my voice, or what, are you okay? Is, you know, and slowly but surely, it's still a mystery to me. There's still a great mystery around my voice that I think God is slowly revealing to me, but may not reveal all of it. I don't know, but I was touring. Leanne Rimes and I did a big tour together in 98. And at the end of that tour, something started to happen with my voice. I did a little Christmas EP, and we were finishing up the year in Vegas that year. And I started to slowly I could feel little things, you know, shortness of breath or you know, wow, I couldn't get to that place, and I started to experience a lot of anxiety. So the following year in 99, you know, we had hundreds and hundreds of dates. You know, we got to keep everybody's rent paid, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, so over the course of, you know, the next 3 months of that new year in 99, it just, my voice just grinded to a halt. And it was just unbearable. I mean, to the point of like where I couldn't produce a tone out of my voice. I mean, wow. It was just like that, you know. And so I finally, after grinding it out and going to vocal coach after vocal coach and hypnotists and everything, yeah, I think I was desperate. You know, I was scared. I was losing this thing that gave me an identity. Right. You know? So it was scary.
Yeah.
Because I think.
Did you have anybody walking with you through this, like say, that you could really say?
A confidant.
Yeah, a friend, a help, or anybody?
Not a close one.
That would understand anyway, probably.
So you felt alone.
Very, very alone. And there were a couple people within my camp that actually said, I'm not sure if your voice is ever going to come back, you might want to consider some other options. And I still hear them reverberating at the foot of my bed every day when I wake up. My beautiful, amazing wife was on a soap at the time in New York City, and I thought, we didn't have kids yet, and so I thought, I'm going to get my car, and I'm just going to go to New York City and hang out with my wife for as long as I want. I still had enough money in the bank, I could do that. And so I went up there, and I was chatting with her German makeup lady in the makeup room while she was on set, and all the way up there, you know, I grew up in church. I didn't go to church a lot, and it was very nominally, you know, and I went, church camp was really where I felt the greatest presence of God. I had an aunt and uncle that were just amazing. You know, they were a really great model of, not that they were perfect, but right. They were really doing the work. And so I think the first real major seeds were planted in some of those summers with my cousins, you know. And so I kind of equate my whole story to, you know, Proverbs 22:6, you know, I came back to what I knew. And so I asked this German lady in makeup room, I said, where do you go to church? I can't remember her name, it was like Glenda or something like that. And she said, oh yeah, I go to the church on 92nd Amsterdam, and you have to go. It's amazing, diverse and beautiful music and great, you know. And so I just felt, you know, I felt like we needed to go. So Erica and I started going to this church, and I got plugged into this men's fellowship, and I started actually reading the Bible for the first time in my life, like actually reading it and trying to understand it. And God slowly began to really reveal himself to me and reveal, you know, like big words that I really never thought much about, like grace and all that kind of stuff. And I started to really wake up and understand, you know, that it's so much bigger than what I make and all this stuff. So did you have a question?
Well, no, I love what you're saying there. Did it begin to reorient that identity? Like, sounds like an identity crisis. If your identity is in what you do, and then that closes shop without your control, it sounds as if your body was responding to what your emotions
sounds to me like the ego died a little.
Right.
Yeah.
And all it hurt. It hurts. Painful. That ego don't like to go.
Painful.
So was that spiritual awakening a way of finding a true identity? Was that part of that?
For sure.
You know, what did you discover in that spiritually speaking?
Well, you know, because men, if you ask a man anything about themselves, they start talking about their career. You know, because that's
your
identity. That's it, you know. And
you're so good, I forgot to eat.
Oh, that's okay. Go for it. And then
you know the conversation's good when you forget to eat.
And when Erica was done at the show there, you know, we had always had our place here, and we got plugged into a church and got really under the wing of some really great people that helped us to kind of start really walking it out. But you know, fast forward, you know, I'm on the right path, very flawed, still working out a lot of stuff in the dirt.
Yeah. Your voice is not any better, right? Or is it? What happens?
I still, to this day, I've gone through bitterness toward God even after getting saved.
Gone. It's gone.
You know, I deal with, you know, I'm not in a state of bitterness now, but I have been through phases where I'm like, Lord, what is up? You know, if this is my livelihood and this is how I'm to continue to provide for my kids, what gives, you know? And there, like I said, there's been a great mystery around my voice and what happened and what's continuing, you know, like how you know, I do have new discoveries along the way. I think that some of it has been potentially neurological.
Sure.
Maybe possibly due to, I've studied so much on my own situation. Maybe due to trauma from being a kid, you know, some abuse and some having an alcoholic father. I see a lot of correlations to that kind of stuff, which I don't doubt has played into it. You know, I dove off of a boat at Lake Texoma when I was a kid, when I was 14, and it was only 2 foot of water, and I just, you know. I mean, just all kinds of little things that you think about because you're trying to put the pieces back together. And then on the physical side, I don't think there's anything wrong with me. I don't think there's anything wrong with me.
So it's a connect here somewhere.
There's nothing wrong with my voice. Mm-hmm. I mean, just the past few months, I've discovered that I'm exhaling all of my air before I even start to sing. And I think there's some kind of little mental mechanism that's coming from fear that's kind of kicking in right before I...
Sure.
And so, you know...
And that can be a learned... I mean, I'm learning a lot about fear, and I have a family member who's dealing with some chronic issues that could stem from fear. We all have anxiety that drives and shuts us down and in different ways. So it's amazing to me, like, that would be the question for me is, like, how do you... That's like dealing with yourself, right? Our humanity. The fact that, okay, so like you're saying, my voice, I think it's fine. I don't think it's a physical thing. I think it's coming from my brain or my heart of this anxiety and fear. Does that ever, I mean, what do we do with that? Do you get better off of that? I mean, you know, that's like some core stuff.
How are you dealing with it? I mean, it's not back. Or are you still singing?
Well, check it out. This is so weird. It's the cliche answer is to trust God. I mean, that's very hard to do sometimes.
Yeah, sure.
But I'm trying. I'm trying to stay strong in my faith and continue on and know at the end of the day that He's got this. And you know, that's a tough one for men, especially.
And for creatives too, I think.
Yeah.
Who lose an aspect of how they create it.
The issue that happens live is sometimes if I hit one snag, my mental
it will set you off.
It's just like you go into
panic
protective mode.
Yes.
And you can't undo it because you're
and
tasking,
then what
you're
happens.
You're engaging with people and you're trying to be, and part of the battle too is I have to constantly remind myself, dude, you're not Bryan White 22.
Yeah.
Let it go. You know, you got gray hair now. So I have to battle that too because
You lowered things?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Don't be proud about that.
Well, Vince, Vince Gill came to my house one time. God bless him for coming and doing this. He played mandolin on a track for me at my house. And we talked about this same thing. And he said, man, why don't you just lower your keys a half step? Just tune your guitar a half step down. And that really did help me a lot. Sometimes I'll tune it down a whole step if I've got a week full of stuff and my voice is
and
just torn up.
And who knows?
Yeah.
Nobody knows the difference.
Right. Well, it's an internal thing. There's such a thing of, I think, especially as men, but I think women do this too. I've heard from women who in their households comparing with other people's kids and how they decorate their home, you know, like, everybody has this internal pressure to be something that I don't think on a
well, when you
perspective,
lower
God's
your expectations, life is a lot easier to
deal with. There you go. There's true religion.
You can help save thousands of lives by giving a generous gift to Food for the Hungry today.
In the rural Dera district of Ethiopia, families are experiencing high death rates in children under 5 due to preventable water-related diseases. They simply don't have access to clean water sources or the infrastructure to practice good health and hygiene.
Until now, we're talking latrines, Andrew. Your gift today will provide families in the Dera district with clean water, health and hygiene training, hand washing stations, and life-saving latrines. And to add to the impact, your gift will be matched 22 times. 22 times.
It's a wonderful opportunity, Mark. Food for the Hungry is already laying the groundwork now to provide a safe place to live for hundreds of thousands of vulnerable children and their families in Ethiopia. I think of Jesus' own words in the Gospels where he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. The people of Ethiopia, Mark, they matter to God, and so they matter to us too. Will you help us let them know they are important to God and to their neighbors across the ocean? That's us.
Give generously today at fh.org/dinner. We're so excited that you'll be giving, that we want to give something to you. We have several add-ons, we call them, where we will be maybe making a special phone call to a friend of yours, a video.
Some little videos, that's right. It's shout-out videos for your friend's birthday, for an anniversary, or maybe like a Zoom conversation with just you, Mark, and me, or even a Zoom party with you and some of your friends. All these are just a simple way to say thank you for the life-saving gift that you're giving to Food for the Hungry for our friends in Ethiopia at fh.org/dinner.
Did you know that at dinner-conversations.com, we have a store? We have been around long enough to produce products.
That you want.
You want this, a Dinner Conversations mug to hold your 8 ounces of coffee in the morning
it's
or less.
Big.
And then one, if you want to look at us, see how intellectual I look with my glasses.
You look like you're judging me.
Well, I am. It gives me that intellectual look.
We also have DVDs full of all of our episodes and a bunch of bonus content you can't find anywhere else. We've got this season one DVD with all kinds of guests like Sandy Patty and Shonda Pierce and Point of Grace. And we've got this season two DVD set. I mean, these are tons of discs. Kathy Lee Gifford, Montel Jordan, Scott Hamilton, Amy Grant. And you know what else we have?
What?
We have the songs from the set CD where we sing a little bit together, but also you'll hear a lot of songs from people like Russ Taff and the Isaacs, some of our very favorites. You can find all of that at dinner-conversations.com.
Well, first of all, it's an honor to sit here with you and play this song. I remember really vividly the day that we wrote this song. It was Michael Boggs and myself and a good friend of mine by the name of Scotty Alexander. And we're all, Michael's the young one. Scotty and I were, I would arguably say that we are middle-aged. And we were kind of having a middle-aged conversation with the younger guy, great songwriter, Michael. And we were just talking about our struggles. And Michael just, you know, out of nowhere, just started kind of going. He even said that line. He said, sometimes I just feel like, you know, we just need a little more faith to believe what we already know. And we just, it was literally one of those moments where when he said that, it just started kind of flowing out of all of us. Mm-hmm. And it came from this really, really primal place for us. And it was one of those days where you, when you were finished, you're like, wow, this is a great song because it's we can always have it in our arsenal for ourselves to help us. And it wasn't, oh man, who's going to cut this? It was,
right.
What a neat piece of music that God has given us that we can continue to encourage ourselves with, you know.
And now encourage a whole lot of other people. Because when I heard it for the first time, it just hit me in a really, really interesting place. And I'm probably the same age as you are. And, you know, growing up in the church, and you still, it doesn't mean you're equipped every single day, every single moment, in every single situation to just persevere like you're a superhero. You still need to be reminded of those things that are the foundational products of your faith.
Absolutely, without question.
Life has been a teacher, an enemy and a friend, and at times I've been a sinner and a saint. I've been known to lose my temper, my patience and my pride, but I've never lost the need to pray. To hold, all I really need is just a little more faith to believe what I already know. You said you'd never leave me, you'd walk right by my side, but right now angels watching over me. Oh, but Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. I don't need some mountain moved for me, or some miracle to behold. All I really need is just a little more faith to believe what I already know. And I know that much bigger problems than mine, but Lord, if you give of gold, all I really need is just a little more faith to believe what I already know. And yeah, the secret to walking down life's road is to believe what I already know.
Fast forward, you know, even to, what was it, 5 years ago or so, we were talking about this before we started rolling, about your song God Gave Me You, which was on that record we were talking about from 16, 17 years ago. That became this huge hit in the Philippines.
I feel like an actor that's trying to time out my next bite while you're,
yeah, go.
I don't know when
I
you're
talk a
stop.
Long time. I don't see
that. Long questions, and he will edit greatly. Really, when you see this, you'll think it's PBS.
I even edit myself.
They'll have me out of the picture.
Yeah. It'll really, it's an interesting one-on-one when the final piece.
I'm just here to eat. I love the food.
But the God Gave Me You thing, here's what I want to say about that. So this became, for those who don't know, this song of yours became literally I mean, a game changer in the Philippines. I mean, how random, number one. You're playing arena shows now in the Philippines because you're now this, you know, musical celebrity because of this song. But it's in a different part of your life by that point in time. Do you feel like the resources of going through some of this, okay, where is my identity? What I do is not who I am. Okay, so starting to discover that and find your voice on a grander scale, did that give you this kind of toolkit when then you blew up in the Philippines and you are having, I mean, I saw videos that went viral of you. I mean, literally people are just mobbing you.
Yeah. Did you handle that different? That's the question.
Well, I cried a lot when I was there because I couldn't believe that that was happening somewhere else to start with. And just to, the fact that it felt familiar was, it reminded me of my youth, and it was just a very surreal, emotional.
Did you enjoy it this time?
I did because I really felt grateful. Not that I wasn't grateful at 22, 23 years old, but I was really grateful as a dad. I was grateful as a, you know, I know how much poverty is over there, and I know how much people struggle over there. There's so much trafficking and so many kids that are abandoned there. Mm. And I knew about that prior to going over because of my brother doing work over there and so many people that knew about the Philippines. And so all those things playing in, it was just like this just giant mesh in my head of all the things that I knew up to that point. It was just, it was all very emotional around every little corner, you know.
Did it feel like this kind of grand, gracious gesture, maybe even from God, to say like...
I would be lying if I said I didn't feel a little twinge of that, you know.
Being loved.
It's almost embarrassing to admit that sometimes, though, isn't it? Because you think, he is so much more gracious than you can even talk about. Because then somebody might think, well, he's playing favorites. But I think he plays favorites to everybody, don't you?
I agree.
Makes you feel like you're his favorite.
And it's not about celebrity. I mean, there may be some people be like, well, this is not relatable because I don't have a celebrity platform, whatever.
Oh,
it's
no.
In each of our careers, in each of our lives, in each of our families, there are these transcendent moments, I think.
Yes.
You know, where God is showing us where his favorite.
Well, you almost see through the veil a little bit.
Think about your kids. So you got
enough
two
about
sons.
Me. Let's talk about you.
No.
No. You're fascinating.
Two sons. So, you know, and they're teenagers now, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're not far away 10 years from being in their own, you know, headlong into their own careers. They've got the male trait. They're probably going to be somewhat obsessed with their career, what they're doing, or, you know, have a lot of passion and motivation towards
what
that.
Are they
How have you discovered with your identity? Like, are you parenting them through what you're learning about how, hey, boys, your identity is not in what you do. It's important what you do, but that's not who you are.
I'm trying my best to impart to them everything that I've learned through trial and error. And I did not have a perfect upbringing. I had a lot of love, but a lot of dysfunction, you know, my brother and I came out of. But so yes, I'm trying to every day. The main thing is, I heard I love you a lot from my mom and from my grandparents. I didn't hear I love you a lot from the men in my life. And that's one thing. I don't let a day go by without letting them know, hey, I love you and I'm proud of you.
Good for
my
you.
Mom, the women did that really well in my life.
Yeah.
But I didn't hear that a lot from the men in my life. I did, but sure. Not, you know.
You know, my dad had the revelation about that you did, because his dad and mom didn't hug, didn't kiss.
That generation, yeah.
And my dad saw his best friend get hugged and kissed by his father before he got on the train for them to go to college. And my father decided right then, I'm going to hug and kiss my kids. So we never knew, not knowing it. And I'm older than you. So but your parents probably are somewhere between me and my dad. I would think, well, they just must not have gotten it either.
Well, my granddad was not outspoken. Definitely was a very loving guy. I mean, just great, great guy, hard worker, but just didn't go there. You know, it was an uncomfortable thing to really kind of wear your heart on your sleeve
right.
for him. And And my dad was kind of the same way. The only time he would get real emotional was when he was drunk, you know. Yeah. then he would tell you how much he loved you, you know.
Oh.
Which, you know, but my dad would have been 64 this year, and my mom is about to be 62. So I have pretty young parents. Wow. Yeah, my mom had me when she was 17.
Okay, yeah.
So,
well, a simple I love yous from a father and a child, I think, can dispel throughout their lives or can help them move past that they have to prove themselves, that what they do has to be their whole being. You know, that's those simple I love yous, your boys will carry with them for the rest of their life. That knowledge when they're in tough places, when their places have trouble
finding
their
voice.
Do they say it back? You know?
Yeah, they do. My youngest is, he's very vocal about it. You know, I can't leave his bedside without him giving me a kiss on the cheek before I go downstairs. Justin is, he's not as outspoken about it, but he definitely says it too, for sure. Yeah. So, yeah. You know, another thing I was thinking about is for a long time, you know, maybe a decade ago, it's hard to believe that this, my thing continues on and has been going on for as long as it has. And we've all got our things that we are, you know, that we were all struggling with. But for a long time, I was really scared to sit somewhere like this in an interview type of thing and talk about those kind of things because it is my livelihood. And what if some promoter sees it and goes, oh, well, crap, I'm not calling Bryan White.
You know? Yeah.
So that was a big fear of mine, too, that caused me to just kind of brush it on the carpet.
Well, how'd you jump that hurdle?
I remember what God says, and it's we overcome the enemy by the word of our testimony and by the blood of the Lamb. So how can I go wrong? How can I go wrong after that? You know. So
what was harder, the career or the husband family thing? Being a good father
and a good husband.
What's the scariest or hardest?
Wow, I don't think any dad thinks they're the greatest dad in the world. They just, you know, because it's so humbling to you know, I think I have a great relationship with my kids and my wife and we're all, you know, we're doing our very best and we have a great time together. My wife's a saint, you know.
Yeah. When it's like that,
it's probably harder to maneuver through, to navigate through a career, you know.
Because that's all.
Do you like where your career is now? Where would you like it to be?
Nobody ever asked me that question.
You got the Bryan White exclusive.
And immediately I want to go to some politically correct answer, answer.
Don't say I'm happy with
I think there's a level of, I think there's really a reservoir still in me that is holding my greatest. But I'm still trying to figure out the mystery. You know, I think if the levee breaks in that or the light goes off or something happens where I feel like I can dip into my, you know, like 92-93%, I think I could see maybe my best record ever, you know, in the future. If God allows that to happen. But maybe he doesn't want
and
that
you're
to
still
happen.
Young.
I don't know.
You know, really.
You're, well, I mean, thanks. I appreciate
it. I mean, you are. Well, if you're not, you look it.
Yeah.
But you do have probably a good 10, 15 of a career left, I would think.
I can think of a lot of things that I'd like to see in a better place career-wise, but I'm very grateful for where I am currently. Yeah.
Well, we're thankful for your voice.
Man, I'm glad.
Thanks, man.
I was kind of getting scared on this story because, you know, I don't know your story. and I was thinking, oh, no, because I was thinking, okay, he's still singing. Oh, no, maybe he ain't still singing. I mean, I was with you.
You're a
storyteller. Yeah. And I'm so glad you're okay.
Thanks, man.
Yeah.
Thank you for watching Dinner Conversations. Don't forget to subscribe and then ring that bell and get all notifications.
And don't forget to like us or dislike us.
No,
don't do that. Leave comments, talk about what's resonating in your life from these conversations, and join us next time for Dinner Conversations with
Mark Lowry
and Andrew Greer.
Turning the light on.
One question at a time.
Dinner Conversations is brought to you by Food for the Hungry, an incredible relief and community development organization serving those with physical and spiritual needs around the world for 50 years this year.
Help us as we help our friends at Food for the Hungry save thousands of lives in Ethiopia today by considering a generous gift.
A gift that will be matched 22 times.
Your one-time gift will make an eternal difference. So visit fh.org/dinner to give now.